First off, welcome. I want to introduce myself. My name is Doug Tripp. I'm the general manager for the sports and entertainment business. And one, I want to thank you guys for all your support of our products. Two, I want to make sure that all of you realize this is really an hour and a half, 2 hours of your time. We truly want to hear what you have to say. We'll answer questions in the best manner possible, try to give you some candid feedback and information. But really, I want to hear from you guys, and I've got the team with me here. Mark Sapir, who handles the sports business. Next to him is Clay Laraski, who handles most of the product development for the sports side. And then David Reel, who is on the sales team for the hobby side of the business. So three very well-versed folks in the room to talk through it. And I think with that, we'll have some raffle and some trivia at the end of the questions. But with that, let's just turn it over to the group and fire away.
So we're going to take questions. Just for everyone.
Do we need this, or can you guys hear us?
Do you guys need the microphone, or am I good?
You're good.
All right. So if you don't hear us, just tell us to speak up. People in the back end here, tell us to speak up. Like Doug said, we're here right now to answer your questions. We don't always have the opportunity to be in front of our collector, so rather than us talking all day, we do that plenty. We want to hear from you. We want questions about whatever it is, the business. Easy questions are preferred. Tough questions will be answered. We're going to go back and forth between the questions and prizes. So all of you, hopefully, will have a chance for a prize, and many of you will leave with a prize. And we're just going to take questions. So if you have a question, just pop your hand up, and we'll go ahead. Go ahead.
Quick question. Is the Bronx autograph WWE top separate?
And if, I will tell you this. If we don't have an answer, which possibly we won't.
Because the group here is predominantly sports. They don't do a lot of the entertainment products.
We may give you a prize for stumping us. As well, we'll take your information and find out. So the WWE question?
Yeah.
This group here is a sports centric.
Yeah.
We love WWE, but it's not in the sports business, it's a little entertainment business.
Can you repeat the question, please?
All right, so I'll repeat the question as well. The question was,
is the Rock's autograph in WWE tops?
The question was, is the Rock's autograph in WWE tops? And you have now stumped us. And I don't expect people to stump us. That's not the idea of this Q&A. So here's your t-shirt for stumping us. Afterwards, let me get your information. I'll get to your answer.
And I will tell you that it's not specifically in the one now, but I do know that the group is working on several conditions as WWE sort of transforms their business. They've seen some challenges in the business in total, and working with them was our licensing partnership. I do know that we're going to see a resurgence in that business, so
Okay, one more thing is all the collectors of WWE want to collect and stay, some kind of license with legends autographs.
Yes. That is in process. So you don't get another shirt. Yes.
Is there any possible way in the future when you put out like the top football this year for the SBs, put in a checklist? Because I've got some now that we don't know which one's which.
But that's the whole fun part about it, is making you search for what's in short print now. usually with the short prints, we'll put out a list a week or two after we've gotten some emails, or just get a little bit of a chase going first. But yes, next week we plan on telling you who the short-printed rookies are and some people who have discovered there are short-printed veterans in Topps football this year as well.
But to Clay's point, that is intentional. And while it may be frustrating for you, in total we think it benefits the business, which collectively we're all in this together. And to have that 10 days of sort of franticness and conspiracy and searching and wondering and community, we think ultimately is best. But at some point, we owe it to collectors, and typically at 10 days or so, Clay will communicate with the SBs on the products.
I love it. It's just knowing, I have both of them in front of me, just knowing which one is
which. And we should, and we will do that 14 days after the release.
Now, can you guys, is it like, in the future, can you tell us like the print run of the short print?
You know, traditionally we don't. Depends on what the short print is and what the product is. But for Topps football and the Topps brands, the short prints that we have announced, we don't list the number.
Why not?
Like I said, it depends on the brand. You know, sometimes we don't want to reveal.
Why not?
What's that?
Why not?
Just don't want to. It's just a choice that we make.
What's the risk?
I think there's pros and cons of announcing that information. I mean, there's pros and cons of announcing on every release what the print run is. To be fair, that number being a mystery has its benefits as a business. If collectors do the run on everything, sort of the uncertainty would go away. And to be fair, that uncertainty benefits the business, and that uncertainty creates sort of what people collect. So if on every product we announce print runs and all that information, some of the vagueness of the business, and I don't think that's tricky on our end, would vanish. And I think that's what collectors thrive on, and this business thrives on. So I think oftentimes we do, but oftentimes we don't, for those reasons.
Print runs and checklists aside, would it not be just a good idea to announce the products on the sell sheet that they're actually going to exist instead of having them pop up and just show up? Because some people, you know, like the variants, if you don't announce that there's variants, some people won't even know that there's variants. And so, but at least having on the sell sheet that there will be variants. We're not telling you who, we're not telling you how many, but there will be variants, just to let people know, instead of somebody finding out 14 days later that, oh, I had a variant and didn't know it.
I don't think there's any perfect, but the question was, why don't we announce at least that there'll be variants? And I think sometimes we do, but I also think sometimes, and again, there's no wrong or right answer to this. It's a delicate balance, but I do think for many collectors, that element of unexpected surprise is important. And I think if we announced everything and everything was known before the product hit, it would take that element of surprise and wow and that fascination out. So sometimes we do.
When it's a good surprise, yes. But when it's a bad surprise, like, oh, I had one of these and now I didn't know I had it and now it's gone.
Right, but again, it's back to that balance. If we announce everything, because what's good and what's bad is open, but it's subjective. If we announce everything up front, then certainly we'd be missing that on the back end. So I think it's a balance. Could we balance better? Probably, but it's a tricky balance. And some stuff we announce, and some stuff intentionally we don't, and I think it helps the category.
Just a quick question. We've seen a move towards on-card autographs for a lot of the baseball products, but we haven't seen it trickle down past the rookies and the football products. Can you elaborate how we're going to see more products like Five Star and move towards a complete on-card set, kind of like what has been done in the past with products outside of your brand, and just moving towards that as a rule of thumb rather than an exception?
Yeah, so what I'm not going to do, I'm not going to sit up here and tell you as a rule of thumb we're moving towards completely on card, because that would be unfair. I do think we understand from a collector's perspective the value of on card, and we're collectors as well, and you know, it would be disingenuous for me to tell you that I would rather have a sticker than an on card. We get that, we know what value it unlocks, we know that for collectors it's more special. And I think we've made strides in the last 2 years to move towards on card. So I think you've seen it in baseball. I do think you've seen it in football. I mean, we could argue whether it's just rookies. Certainly rookies logistically is easier for us to pull off. We've done some high-end on card, and I think in total we've made strides. And I could be wrong, but I think more than other manufacturers in the last 2 years, we've made bigger strides. But then the business reality, and Clay will help me on this, is on card autographs, as much as we'd love to do everything, they create massive logistical issues, massive issues, and massive redemption issues. And as an organization, if we go too far towards on card, they're going to come with their implications. They're going to come with more redemptions, unfortunately. They're going to come with our inability to get products out on time. So it's a balance. So we know. know collectors want on card, we hear it. We're trying to do our best effort to get on card without disrupting our business and our ability to deliver you guys products on time without redemptions.
I mean, I give you guys credit. Don't get me wrong. I mean, I love the Finest, Chrome. All of these products now have rookie hard sign elements to them, which is unbelievable. I give you all the credit in the world. Yeah. But Five Star was such an unbelievable success.
Yeah.
I want to see more of it.
Yeah, right. We'd like to see more of it too, but I can tell you Five Star, like, I'm glad it was a success for all of you. It was a headache. And I don't take headaches. That's our job. We're here to create great products for you. But I'm not looking for sympathy. That thing was a beast for us to get done. And that's why it ended at the end of the year, because it was a beast.
But it paid off.
Another thing to add too on the football stuff is the Players Association blacks out a certain period during the football card season where we're not allowed to get autographs.
Mm-hmm.
So it makes it difficult for some products to be on card regardless.
That makes sense.
Is that the reason why the rookie premiere are on card?
Yeah, so the question was, is that why the rookie premiere cards were on card? And it's a good question. The rookie premiere gives us a perfect venue where all the rookies are there for us to get cards signed on card. The challenge is, not to get too deep into this and bore you, but the challenge is, that means we have to have all the cards pre-printed, and we have to know the volumes to pre-print those. And oftentimes, those decisions are being made blindly because we ultimately don't know how many we need for each of the next four releases, I call it. So we try and get as many on cards there as we can, but it's not as if at that shoot, we could do on card for the rest of the year because we just wouldn't have those cards ready and we wouldn't know the volumes to have those. But we'd use that as a window with Rising Rookies, with Inception, to get as much as we can signed up front at that event.
Because you know who's going to be there.
Because we know who's going to be there. We know we're going to be getting their autographs. We have a feel at least for the next two, three products volume-wise of what we're going to do. And this year, Clay's team did a great job of making sure we took advantage of that. And you're seeing it in Inception, which will be out next week. You're seeing it in Rising Rookies. You're seeing more on card up front because of that.
You and Cardinal Shore.
Is there any way you guys are looking into try to do tier packs or being like reduced retail? Because I mean, you go to buy platinum baseball, and all purple refractors are all slid down where people are trying to cherry pick the Harvards.
Yep. I mean,
that's a clear pack. If you wrap it some differently, but these guys won't be trying to find the security stuff.
It's a good question. And it's not, so the question was, what can we do better to avoid pack searching at retail? And, you know, one thing I'd say is I give collectors credit because you guys are crafty and you guys are smart. And every time we think we sort of have a way of hiding things, collectors find new ways of search packing. So part of it is just a game of, what is it, mouse and cat and mouse? Because like we think we got it, and then they find some new clever little thing and this and that. So part of it, we're always going to be sort of chasing each other. Part of it is, you know, we do make an effort with decoys, with packaging to minimize that. When we hear things, I don't know if you guys know this, there was a clear package and there were 2 million giveaway code cards in it. And we found out, like, collectors were being crafty and going through the back of it and taking the codes off the back of the cards. Yeah. And honestly, like, we didn't ever, maybe it's our fault, like, we never anticipated that being an issue. Maybe we should have thought through they could move 3 cards and lift up the plastic. It just wasn't considered. And we need to be more cognizant of that stuff, knowing collectors are looking, or some collectors are. When we found that out, I mean, we learned our lesson and then we put a blank on the back of that. So a lot of it's cat and mouse. You know, I think we've made a big effort. Obviously, there are cost implications, and at the end of the day, it's somewhat a trade-off, because if we did everything to minimize that, let's say it costs $1 million, that would mean $1 million less that we could go out and add hits and content to the product. So it's an ongoing balance. I think we've made an effort. I know we've made an effort, and you know, we're going to continue to listen to collectors. When we hear things, we adjust, and we got to continue to get better at minimizing that. I don't know that we'll ever be 100%. But I think we've made strides and we got to continue going after it. And as a group, as collectors, I mean, if there are things that you see, I would encourage you guys to let us know, because we're not always there at retail as much as we'd like. And if you guys see things, bring it to our attention. Okay? Right there.
Staying on that theme, is there any database, you know, little batch picking going on? Is there ever going to be a database or something like that?
Yeah. It's a good question. The question was, there's a lot of fakes out there. And the question is, what are we going to do about it? So it's a good question. And, you know, we don't like fakes. Unfortunately, we also don't have the ability to police, you know, the internet and eBay. I wish we did. I mean, it would require probably another 100 people to 40 staff. So it's hard for us to police it. When things are brought to our attention, typically, you know, we try and look into it. It's hard for us to look into anything. But the two things I'll say is, one, up front on our end, we do things clean. So we get our jerseys from clean vendors. We have specific things in place to make sure everything we put in product is legit. And we're committed to that, and I believe that. Separately, there are these people out there who are bad, and they do sneaky things. So we've looked at different ways to temper that. And the challenge we have, again, we're going to be candid with you. The challenge we have is, there are possibly systems in place, which we're looking at, but for us to enforce those and to integrate those into our product would cost significant dollars. And again, it's a trade-off. So we could pump in $3 million so that everything was trackable and had an RFID or whatever technology we're looking at. But then as a business, we're like, if we put $3 million in that, we can't advertise and grow the category. We can't make sure that collectors still get 2 hits per box, and it's a business decision.
Or your price goes up.
Or you guys take that $3 million and you see your price go up. So it's tough. You know, we're looking at things to be fair for sure, but right now we haven't found something that makes sense for the business collectively.
With the amazing reception that Panini has been getting at specifically at the National with the